Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
6th of September, every year passes in India like any other day. Nobody particularly takes notice of it. Next door, in Pakistan, it's a day of big celebration, big parades, and a big surge of patriotism. Why does it happen? Because in Pakistan, 6th September is celebrated as Defense of Pakistan Day or Defense Day, National Defense Day. Parades take place, flypasts take place. It is in some ways akin to their Republic Day. Now, why does that happen? Because 6th September is when the Pakistanis believe that the 1965 war began. That is 54 years ago. In India, first of all, we don't particularly celebrate anything about that war because that war was completely indecisive and inconclusive. But also in India, we don't quite believe that the war, that war began on December 6th. On September 6th. In India, we believe that war began on September 1. And in fact, if you ask me, I would say maybe that war began in the first week of August, or maybe even in April that year, or maybe even in December 1963. That's almost 2 years before when a full frontal conflict actually took place. So, because this is the anniversary of that war, there is big tamasha in Pakistan today, 6th of September. Pakistanis also believe, by the way, wrongly, that they won that war. Because winning a war, what does it mean? Did you achieve any of the objectives with which you had started the war? On that, Pakistan achieved zero, right? It lost a lot of people, tanks, aircraft. India lost a lot of people, tanks, aircraft. Both sides suffered severely at a time when both countries were quite poor and dependent on foreign aid, but nothing was achieved in that war. Definitely, for the side that started the war, that is Pakistan, the achievements below the bottom, at the bottom line were zero, 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 if not negative, negative, negative. But for whatever reason, they celebrate that day. And now there have been some responses in India, particularly among writers, military historians. Also at this point, the environment is quite fraught. And also given the context in which the 65 war was held, it was the specific context of Kashmir that I think it is important right now and interesting for me to try and declutter a few points. If I started telling you the history of the entire war and the turning points, I love military history and I read everything that's available on it. But that will take too long. And maybe in the course of time, we will talk about some aspects as and when they become relevant. But let me just tell you basically what happened in 65. And why did the war happen in 65? And why did Pakistan begin the war? And why I think it was the war of mutual military incompetence. It is something that I've written with the same headline in the past. And why, instead of winning the war, India did not win the war, but instead of winning the war, Pakistan actually lost that war. Now, around wars, mythologies are created by all nations. Nobody's an angel. In this case, Pakistan has created the bigger central mythology about the 65 war. Now, 65 is to be seen in the context of 1962. 1962 is when the Indian Army suffered a big humiliating defeat at the hands of the Chinese. So Indian Army was quite weakened. After 62, there was a massive expansion of Indian Army. New units were raised. There was a shortage of officers. There was a shortage of weaponry. Any organization that goes through sudden expansion has those problems. Pakistan, on the other hand, in 1956, we talked about this earlier, 55-56, Pakistan became a member of the American-led strategic organizations, that is Baghdad Pact, SEATO, Southeast Asian Treaty Organization, CENTO. These are all sort of adjuncts to NATO or NATO-like formations, whereby Pakistan now became an active American ally and recipient of enormous amounts of aid, but more importantly, high-tech, cutting-edge military equipment at that time. So at a time when Indian Army was recovering from this great humiliation and disarray, the chief had to resign, the corps commander who lost the battle against the Chinese in Nefa, what is now called Arunachal, he was made to go, the defense minister was made to go, and this expansion was taking place. So Indian Army was in a state of confusion. Also, all three forces, Army, Navy, Air Force in India, had a negative technology gap vis-a-vis the Pakistanis. If you want to see it more closely, Indian tanks could not fight at night, Pakistanis tanks could fight at night. Most Indian tanks did not have the guns of the size or caliber and bore that could cut through, that could pierce the Pakistani patent tank's armor. Only a few Indian Centurions had that. Indian Air Force was not yet in missile age. Pakistan Air Force was in missile age. So a large number of Pakistani Sabres and all of Pakistan's F-104 star fighters, which was I think about a dozen and a half, they were all equipped with air-to-air missiles. Indian Air Force wasn't. So one Air Force fought in one plane, one in the other. Second, Pakistan Air Force was night capable. Indian Air Force was not yet night capable. Pakistan had much better radars than India. Pakistan Navy had a submarine. India did not have a submarine. In fact, not only did it not have a submarine, but Indian ships, surface ships, had very poor anti-submarine warfare capability. So in all three forces, Pakistan had technological superiority by a quantum level over India. India, of course, had numerical superiority, but remember, India also had to allocate 10 mountain divisions along the borders with China, because just 3 years earlier, or less than 3 years earlier, India had suffered that humiliating defeat to the Chinese. There was no way India was going to denude that border and move those forces here. Also because China and Pakistan by this time had become very strong allies. So the Pakistanis thought after 62 that now is our chance to use our military superiority and India's military disarray to move in and take Kashmir by force. So this operation began, in my view, in 1963, December. That's when the famous incident of the loss of the holy relic, Prophet Muhammad's relic, which is kept in the Hazrat Bal Mosque or Shrine in Srinagar, that disappeared. That led to massive disturbances and public anger. Pakistanis thought they could then exploit it and build some kind of a popular insurrection. That's a long story, someday I will talk about it, and many books have been written about it. It was then handled very deftly in the end and calmed down, but it left people angry. So that was the first bit of softening that the Pakistanis carried out as part of the same operation. Second, now by 1965, Pakistanis thought this was the time now to strike, because Indian defense modernization was now picking up. Because what started in 1963 after the defeat at the hands of the Chinese was now beginning to show some results. Some units were forming, some new equipment had come in, and India was focusing on defense. Remember, India also had a very good defense minister, Y.B. Chavan. Countries win wars when they have good defense ministers. So Pakistanis realized or thought or miscalculated that this was the time, because if they leave it for another couple of years, then Indian military will now strengthen itself and Pakistan will lose this edge which the Pakistanis thought was decisive. So Field Marshal Ayub Khan was Pakistan's strongman at that point. Zulfikar Ali Bhutto was a Sancho Panza and somebody who instigated a lot of this mischief. And they thought this is the time now when we should push and take Kashmir militarily, because another opportunity will not come, and I will revisit that statement in a couple of minutes. So what did they do? They still wanted to be sure that they were militarily superior. So April of 1965, Pakistan launched a limited thrust, maybe a division-sized thrust in penny pockets, maybe a division was involved, but maybe troops and equipment worth about a couple of brigades was involved in the run of Kutch, which is a kind of marshy area on the Gujarat border between India and Pakistan. In those skirmishes, Indian forces, as I said, they were still coming out of the mess of the 62 war. Indian forces came out less than equal. And in the process, Pakistan was able to capture some territory. Little bit, but they were able to capture some territory. Pakistan also got the sense that while Indian forces were pushed back, just a little factoid, among the young officers fighting with the Indian units in that area was a Major Krishna Swami Sundarji, who later became Chief of Staff. So, as the Indian forces were pushed back, Lal Bahadur Shastri's government, which was quite new, 64, Nehru had died. So, there was a further impression that India had weakened, and India's resolve had weakened, or that Shastri was a weak leader. Shastri did not escalate in Kutch, because he decided that this was not the best place and time to do this. The Pakistanis misread that to mean that Indians did not have the resolve to fight. So, once again, confirmation, take Kashmir by force now. So, why do I then say that you could say that this war began not on 6 September or 1st September, but maybe in August that year? Because in August that year, very early August, Pakistanis launched what was called as Operation Gibraltar. Why Gibraltar? Because it was from Gibraltar that the Muslim forces had launched an operation to take over Spain, or take over from the history of the Crusades. So they thought, now we will use Islamic forces. We'll use Islamic forces in a Gibraltar-like operation and drive these infidels out of Kashmir. And they also miscalculated, that people of Kashmir will rise in insurrection. No such thing happened. That operation came a cropper. But there was a situation by the middle of August when it looked like Kashmir Valley was up in flames, because more than 10,000 Pakistani regulars dressed as civilians, fully armed, had infiltrated the Kashmir Valley. To read more about that, read some of the writings of Lieutenant General Harbakhsh Singh, who was then the Western Army commander. At that point, there was no Northern Command. So, Western Army used to control all of the border, India-Pakistan border, except Rajasthan onwards. So, he was controlling Kashmir as well, and he's written in great deal about this. So, I will read you a quote, and that's very interesting, from the Pakistani general who planned this operation. He was a brilliant Pakistani general. His name was Major General then, later he became Lieutenant General, Akhtar Hussain Malik. He was commanding 12th Division of Pakistan Army, and he had planned this. He wrote a line which is such a brilliant, such an enduring line, and I will tell you why enduring. He said, defreeze the Kashmir, this operation Gibraltar was launched to defreeze the Kashmir problem, weaken Indian resolve, and bring India to the conference table without provoking a general war. Why do I say it is so prescient and so interesting and so important? Because that's been Pakistan's strategy in Kashmir all through. They tried the same thing in Kargil, that start this, fight under the nuclear umbrella, this war will not be escalated, Kashmir will be brought under international attention, India will be forced to come on the negotiating table, and their resolve will break because they know that now with the nukes you can't go to war. Yet again, the Pakistanis tried that with something like, say, Pulwama. So, Pakistanis have tried this again and again and again and again. Again, the same formula, defreeze the Kashmir problem, weaken Indian resolve, and bring India to the conference table without provoking general war. So, that did not succeed in 1965. And when it looked like this operation was failing, Operation Gibraltar, and that's why I say, on the Indian side, we believe that the war started, proper war started on September 1. On September 1, regular Pakistani forces with tanks, artillery, a division plus, invaded the area of Cham, which was very lightly defended by the Indian side, because the Indian side there came under the regulations of the United Nations observers. So, India was not allowed to keep heavy tanks or heavy artillery there. So if I read Pakistani accounts, Pakistani military historian Major A.H. Amin, he said when the Pakistanis attacked there, Pakistani superiority in tanks was 6-1. And these were 6 patterns against 1 AMX-13 tanks. AMX-13s were tin boxes. They were light tanks for light operations, not really for an armor fighting role. There was 1 brigade against about 5 brigades worth of Pakistani forces. So they were pushed back very quickly. And remember, and I'll keep coming back to it, who was commanding that division on the Pakistani side? Who commanded that attack on the Pakistani side? It was Major General Akhtar Hussain Malik, the same officer who had earlier planned Op Gibraltar. Now, this was becoming a very difficult situation for India because these Pakistani forces had broken through. They had crossed the Tawi River. They were coming closer to Akhnoor town and could have threatened Jammu. And if this had succeeded, if this had lasted another 48 hours, because India was not able to defend that area, Pakistanis were moving, Pakistanis would have succeeded in cutting off all of the Indian garrisons in all of Kashmir, and then India would have had no choice but to sue for peace or wait for their forces to be cut down and for Kashmir to be taken by Pakistan militarily. Now, two reasons it did not happen. One, let me reverse the order in terms of chronology. One, by September 6, Lal Bahadur Shastri's government, which was seen to be weak, took a very tough decision. And this is something which had been gamed in the past. In fact, there are accounts, written accounts in books of that period, and many of these books, we will be talking about, or we'll be mentioning, so you can go to the library or you can Google them and read about them. There were accounts also of YB Chauhan, Gulzarilal Nanda, who was Home Minister, and the Army Chief and the Western Army Commander having conversations, say, in the circuit house in Jalandhar. Before this had started, before this stuff had hit the fan, rehearsing or talking about what India could do across the international borders if the pressure became too much in Kashmir, because it was evident that Pakistan would do something silly in Kashmir. So on 6th of September, early morning, Indian Army crossed the international border in Wagah, exactly not far from where this nonsensical parade takes place now on both sides. They crossed the border and the Pakistanis were taken by complete surprise, and within no time, the forward units of India's 15th Division had crossed the Ichogil Canal. It's a big canal which also serves as a ditch cum bandh protecting Western Pakistan from India. They had crossed the canal in many places and they were near the Bata shoe factory on the outskirts of Lahore. And Pakistani armed forces had not yet woken up. They were taken by surprise. And then a bunch of things happened and Pakistanis hit back. Their Air Force came into action. Indian Air Force had not yet come into action. The Indian general there lost his nerve. It was the same general who lost his nerve in Arunachal or Nefa also 3 years earlier, but he was among those who got away. So remember what we keep on saying, that old Punjabi line of wisdom, one who's a disaster in Lahore is also a disaster in Peshawar. So that general had to be fired. Now, because that thrust was stopped at that place and Lahore, Indian forces did not enter Lahore, although I do not believe that was ever the plan. Because that happened, Pakistanis say, oh, we foiled India's big ambitious plan to take Lahore, etc. So this is Defense of Pakistan Day. From the Indian side, this is when, because of this pressure in the Punjab sector, this served its purpose, because immediately the Pakistanis panicked and they stopped the operations in the Chumb area and they began withdrawing their forces to defend their heartland of Punjab. So their Kashmir operation and Kashmir dream was over on September 6, because that's when they figured that they had made a miscalculation. It's a miscalculation they've kept on making even after that. They've always made it. They thought, even in 65, that they could confine the fighting to Kashmir, that somehow Kashmir is not the same as the rest of India. that the Kashmir-Pakistan border, or what was then called ceasefire line and now line of control, is not really a border. So you can do what you want across it. And if you do it, India will not retaliate across what is called as international border. India in 1965, on 6th of September, this date, Lal Bahadur Shastri said, that logic doesn't apply. You hit us anywhere, we'll hit you anywhere. You cannot choose where to fight because everything is Indian territory, including all of Kashmir. That is something that's been now formalized with the abrogation of Article 370, etc. So 6 September is when, and then there were many battles fought. Some were fought wisely by both sides. So they led to a stalemate. Some were fought stupidly by one side, or some were fought brilliantly by one side. So Battle of Khemkaran fought stupidly by the Pakistanis, brilliantly by one Indian brigade, which was up against an entire strike force of Pakistan, an entire armored division, where the tank patterns got really badly mauled. There was Sialkot, where I think in most cases both sides were incompetent. Finally, in one particular battle, it looks like one Pakistani colonel did brilliantly, that we've written about on the print some time back. He passed away recently. And Indian officers, including Captain Amrinder Singh, who's written the definitive history of 65 war, paid rich compliments to him. So this then petered out into a war of mutual incompetence, where nothing happened. Now, for me to make you understand a bit more about it quickly, first of all, let me come back to one of the books written by Lieutenant General Harbakht Singh. Because he was a brave general, highly decorated. He had fought every war that India fought from 47 onwards. He was also among the first officers to reach Srinagar when the infiltrators had come in 47. Now, from his book, one of his books, War Dispatches, I am quoting two paras to you. If somebody were to write this today, he would be immediately dismissed as anti-national. And then our commando comic channels will go, my favorite expression, apocalyptic. How dare he say like this? But this was the man who commanded the Indian Army in that war. He was the Western Army commander. That war, 95% of that war was fought by the Western Army. So two passages from his book. One is talking about the action in Sialkot, where India used its main strike force, the 1st Armored Division. He says, general public was caught in the mania of prevailing self-adulation, and it lapped up with smug satisfaction the inflated figures of enemy casualties and armor. It was also natural that in the first flush of victory, we should be carried away by sentiments in which cold logic found no place. This is Lieutenant General Harbakht Singh in his war dispatches. Then he says, we were carried away by sentiments in which cold logic found no place. In fact, an objective assessment of that at that stage would have been frowned upon as unpatriotic, because you had to go with the propaganda. Lieutenant General Harbakht Singh, not an anti-national character. So he said, so we did a lot of mutual back-thumping, his expression. And then he goes on to say, but when the dust settled and the achievements of one corps, that is Sialkot sector, were viewed in their correct perspective, stripped of the aura of sensation, the initial feeling of exultation gradually gave way to disillusionment. Now you know why I call it the war of mutual incompetence. And then he goes on to say, we were able to whittle down the strength of Pakistani army, but we were not able to destroy it. Then he says, we were able to maul Pakistan's famous and formidable tank forces, but we were not able to cripple them. So this is a military man. He's saying, we were able to maul them, we were not able to cripple them. And here is somebody who had led that famous destruction of Patton tanks in Asal Uttar in Khemkaran. But he's also making this realistic assessment. And then he says, and how we suffered such a high proportion of casualties among young officers.
who carried the day for India in that war, so heavy that an enormous void was created in junior leadership of the Indian Army. So once again, this was a very costly war that achieved nothing for any side. You ask me who won the war? The onus on winning the war lies on the side that starts the war, because the side that starts the war has an objective. Side that defends, the main objective is to defend and to create as much attrition on the other side as possible. To that extent, Pakistan lost that war, because Pakistan started that war with very clear objectives and with superiority on land, in air, and on the seas, but achieved zilch, because even if they achieved a little territory in Khemkaran and Chamb, etc., they lost a lot more in Kashmir. They lost the pass of Haji Pir and much else that was strategic. They lost a lot of territory in their Punjab and elsewhere too. So this is a war that Pakistan lost, because all their objectives, none of their objectives were achieved, and they suffered heavy damage. This is a war that India did not win, because it was really a holding war for India. India did not have an objective, and it was not able to cripple Pakistani army or cripple their tank forces despite the damage that they suffered. Now let me come to something else. I talked about Major General Akhtar Hussain Malik, and I told you, I will tell you something about that. First day of the assault in Chamb, Pakistani assault in Chamb, that assault was called Operation Grand Slam. When Gibraltar failed, they launched Grand Slam. First day of Operation Grand Slam, Pakistan made brilliant progress. There was one Indian brigade which was nearly decimated. I had the opportunity once at a seminar to listen to the officer who had commanded that brigade then. And he described what had happened to his brigade, how everything fell to pieces, because he was under such attack by such superior forces, and it was a brilliantly led attack. The second day of fighting, when it looked like after a little bit of refitting, this was 65, so technology and engineering was not that good, Pakistani forces took a little breath and they thought they'll resume fighting. Suddenly, the chief of staff of Pakistani army arrived by helicopter in the battlefield in Chamb with another general with him and told Major General Akhtar Hussain Malik to hand over to this other general. This other general's name was Major General Yahya Khan. We all know his name. Now, why this was done still remains debatable. I know this is a war that's been much written about, so I'm also picking up some elements which we might not be so familiar with in India. Now, why was he? He was winning that war. Next day, suppose everything had gone to plan, and next day he had taken Akhnoor, and a day later he was in Jammu. Kashmir would have been in Pakistan's bag. He would have been Pakistan's most famous general ever. That was the problem, or maybe that was the problem. That's why someone else had to get that credit for victory, not Major General Akhtar Hussain Malik. Why is debatable. Military historians have talked about it, but I will tell you a fact. Major General Akhtar Hussain Malik was a Ahmadi. So people of Ahmadi community in Pakistan and elsewhere believe that Pakistani establishment, even in 1965, did not want to let an Ahmadi general become such a big national hero. So in the middle of a battle that he was winning, he was replaced by somebody else. General Malik later passed away in Turkey in a road accident. He was posted to the CENTO mission by the Pakistanis. But this little factor remains in Pakistan's history. Now, there is much else that you find by way of reference in Pakistan's military history. There is a book by Lieutenant General Sarfaraz Khan, who led the Pakistani defense of the Lahore sector, who also wrote in an article in 1984 in Daily Jung, Urdu paper, Pakistan's Urdu paper, and said this victory had been snatched away from Pakistan because the establishment did not want an Ahmadi general to have that victory. Now, you know, life has a strange way of getting even with you. Because until Bhutto declared Ahmadis to be apostates or to be non-Islamic, they were prejudices, but there was no there was no open discrimination against it. So 1971 Bangladesh war, because the lay of the land favors Pakistan, they once again launched a big assault in Cham. Indian defense was much better. Indian armed forces fought enormously better. Yet Pakistani forces took Cham. And that was primarily the brilliance of Pakistan's commander then. His name was Major General Iftikhar Khan Janjua. You know how life gets even with you? Major General Iftikhar Khan Janjua was also an Ahmadi. So he became another famous Ahmadi general of Pakistani army. And then what happened? Just as they were savoring their gains and they were hoping then to invest areas beyond the Tawi River, as they had tried in 1965, General Janjua was surveying the scene in his helicopter. We don't know what happened. It is widely believed that some Indian soldiers sitting there targeted the helicopter. Helicopter was shot. It hit a tree. It fell. And General Janjua died right there. So he then became the senior most Pakistani officer to die in battle. So I know that war stories are interesting, but they also bring a lesson. The larger lesson they bring is that a war never solves a problem. Usually, when a war takes place, in the course of time, it leads to another war. Unless both sides accept the fact that a war, a future war, will never solve a problem. That is something that the Europeans did after the Second World War. That is the kind of thing India and Pakistan have to do at some point, because both countries have strong armies, both countries have very patriotic citizens and soldiers, both countries at various points of time will match each other in competence and brilliance and incompetence and stupidity. So there is very little possibility of one country winning anything from the other decisively in a war. Whatever could happen decisively has happened in Bangladesh in 1971, and that too has not solved the India-Pakistan problem. So once again, when you think of wars, when you celebrate the histories of your wars, remember the soldiers who fought those wars, remember those who made those sacrifices, but remember also that these things sound a lot more exciting to those of us who do not go and risk their life and limb.